Hello, everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. Hundreds of mourners gathered at the Martin Luther King Jr. International Chapel on the campus of Morehouse College to pay tribute to Mrs. Evelyn Lowery, wife of prominent civil rights leader Dr. Joseph Lowery. Mrs. Lowery fought for equality and dedicated her life to service. Music filled the rafters in the King Chapel. A host of ministers, loved ones, and ordinary citizens honored the life and legacy of Evelyn Lowery, who passed away on September 26th.
Thank you for Evelyn Lowery, for this soldier of the cross. In fact, Lord, thank you for this General Evelyn Lowery.
His eyes.
A moving hymn by Jennifer Holliday paved the way for a service of tributes from activists such as Ernona Clayton, Reverend Al Sharpton, and Mayor Kasim Reed. They were all there to celebrate the homegoing of this fervent civil rights leader.
It is so often said in this world that behind every great man there is a great woman. Reverend Dr. Joseph Echoes Lowery is indeed a great man. And her life's work will ensure that Evelyn Gibson Lowery will be remembered as a great woman in her own right. But I do not believe that anyone who knew her and her own story would say that she was behind anybody.
A leader in her own right, Mrs. Lowery could be found on the front lines fighting for freedom, shoulder to shoulder with her partner in life and in prayer.
Whether it was women's rights, civil rights, human rights, whether it was leading the line, or whether it was making sure the line went forward, she was there.
While her husband served as president of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, Evelyn Lowery turned her sights on the women of the movement and created SCLC Women, an organization keenly focused on the concerns of women, children, families, and the needs of the disenfranchised.
In her own way, she forged a path for greatness on her journey to do goodwill, not for any personal glory, but rather for the sake of those less fortunate. She was passionate in her commitment to construct memorials for heroes and sheroes of the catalytic movement that changed our country.
Mrs. Lowery stands as a classic role model for women. She was a shining example of a woman who helped create a more just and equitable society by creating possibilities for others to thrive. Mrs. Lowery will be remembered as a trailblazer, a visionary, a distinguished leader of leaders. We are grateful for this great spirit. I love you so.
She will be missed. Mayor Reed and Councilwoman Joyce Shepherd hosted a public safety town hall meeting in District 12 to give residents an opportunity to talk about their public safety concerns. The group also discussed various city initiatives from economic development to city services. The town hall meeting was an important tool in keeping residents engaged.
With the kind of support that we've had, we've been able to add the additional units that we need. We are 20 officers short of 2,000 officers. Putting more police officers on the street is essential for us to be able to have the resources on the street to respond.
When we have a town hall meeting like the kind we're having tonight, and you give us feedback and tell us what's wrong, if we need to shift resources to your community, we have a big enough police force where it means that we're not taking from somebody else's neighborhood in order to shift them towards yours.
The mayor is making his way across the city with public safety town halls to hear directly from constituents. After nearly 4 years of promises, big plans, and large donations, Mayor Reed officially kicked off his Centers of Hope initiative at the Ben Hill Recreation Center. The mayor was joined by council members, city officials, and public and private sponsors. Of the 10 sites that were picked to become Centers of Hope, 4 will have programs administered by the Boys and Girls Club of Metro Atlanta. That's Ben Hill, Adamsville, Thomasville Heights, and Pittman Recreation Centers. All of the centers of hope are within 2.5 miles of more than 90% of Atlanta's youth. In addition to programs that focus on education, character development, and recreation, kids will also get full bellies.
For a 180-day school year, more than 140,000 meals and snacks will be served to students enrolled in our Centers of Hope program.
Centers of Hope sites will also be wired with free Wi-Fi by the end of the year. Ben Hill is already fully connected. Parks and Recreation will launch a program in 2014 to provide free Wi-Fi to all of its 33 recreation centers. With both Friendship and Mount Vernon Baptist Churches agreeing to move, the Atlanta Falcons will have a new stadium at the corner of MLK and Northside Drive. Mayor Reed played a key role in the negotiations to have the new stadium built on the south site. Easy access to MARTA and the Georgia World Congress Center made the location desirable. The new stadium hopes to bring much-needed redevelopment to the area, with both the Atlanta Falcons and Invest Atlanta chipping in for community projects. Both deals total over $30 million to be paid by the Falcons and the Georgia World Congress Center Authority. That new retractable roof football stadium may see a little college action. The City of Atlanta announced its bid for college football's 2018 National Championship game. When the Atlanta Falcons aren't dirty birding in the new stadium, the city wants to use the facility to host other major events like this national title game. Falcons owner Arthur Blank says Atlanta is a world-class city with a strong track record of success in hosting major events. We hope our new stadium will serve as a centerpiece for the 2018 National Championship game, as well as in many of the ensuing years. Team Atlanta is leading the bid. The team includes the Falcons, local and state officials, the Chick-fil-A Bowl, the Atlanta Convention and Visitors Bureau, and the Georgia World Congress Center. Team Atlanta is pooling all of its resources together to come out with the winning bid. Atlanta Fire Rescue plans to upgrade fire stations after receiving a FEMA grant worth over $500,000. The grant is aimed at improving facilities, training, code enforcement, and inspections. $250,000 will be spent on new backup generators for stations 8, 10, 17, 19, and 38. Over $266,000 will be used to purchase technology for the department's Incident Command Training Simulator classroom, and nearly $37,000 will be used to support fire inspections automation.
They will have tablets, to use that generic term, that's loaded with appropriate software in order that all the buildings in Atlanta that require an annual inspection will be loaded into this tablet. They eliminate that hour and a half on the front end and that coming back to the office at the end of the day, completing reports. That will be integrated into just a normal work day.
The Atlanta Police Department is using technology to predict crime. PredPol analyzes crime data, including location and time, and it generates 500 square foot areas that officers should keep an eye on. The department began a 90-day test of the software back in July in zones 4 and 6. Commanders find the technology useful when deploying officers.
If you have a box on your beat, then we want you to spend as much time as you can in that box, not neglecting any calls you have to go on or any other hot spots that you know of, but be in that box as much as you can.
PredPol analyzes APD's crime data every 5 minutes and generates a map of possible crimes for every 8-hour shift. The software originated in Los Angeles, where it has been credited with reducing crime. 2013 marks 30 years that Habitat for Humanity has been in Atlanta. Habitat for Humanity International started in Americus, Georgia in 1976 as an effort to build homes for hard-working, deserving families. The organization has reached so many people who want to be first-time home buyers.
Habitat is so important because it allows hard-working Atlantans who've never had a chance to own a home, never had a chance to buy a home, they thought they'd spend their whole lives as renters, to actually seize the American dream and own a home.
Clark Howard has been building affordable houses with the nonprofit organization for 18 years, and he's helped build 50 houses. Mayor Reed joined Turner Broadcasting employees for the kickoff of Turner Volunteer Day. Volunteers fanned out across more than 30 different sites to offer their help. This is the 15th year Turner Broadcasting has held the Volunteer Day. The company has also been a big supporter of the Centers of Hope.
When I got elected mayor, two-thirds of all of the recreation centers for our children were closed, shuttered. They were horrible places. With the support of Turner, we've opened every single one, and you all have contributed more than $800,000 so that 1,500 kids get help every single week.
Outgoing Turner Broadcasting President Phil Kent has been a staunch supporter of Mayor Reed. Current Time Warner Chief Financial and Administrative Officer John Martin will replace Kent at the helm of Turner beginning next year. City Council President Cesar Mitchell and DoSomething.org kicked off the Give a Spit About Cancer campaign, which seeks to save the lives of patients affected with blood cancers by increasing the number of young people on the National Bone Marrow Registry. Research shows bone marrow donations are most successful when the donors fall between the ages of 18 to 24. Mitchell says he is honored to be a part of the drive to increase young adult participation in the Bone Marrow Registry program. The campaign runs through December 19th. President Mitchell and Councilman Michael Bond want to bring awareness to the exploitation of young girls and women. Folks from the Restorative Justice Center and the I Am Not Yours campaign announced the Diamond on the Half Shell benefit coming up on October 24th. Diamond on the Half Shell was created to help women in jail.
We really have a community of women who have been incarcerated and who've been released or who are going to be released. Who really need our community to wrap our arms around them. And that takes resources, it takes partnership, and it takes a willingness to be a part of the solution.
You see the combined effort of the courts, the policymakers, our mayor, the administration, and the nonprofit sector coming together to make sure that our children, our women are protected.
Atlanta's Restorative Justice Center advocates enhancing court programs that improve outcomes for offenders, victims, and the larger community. And the I Am Not Yours campaign, founded by Mona Steven and actress Jasmine Guy, provides financial support to assist organizations that help young girls and women have a better chance in life. Council members Keisha Bottoms, Natalie Archibong, and Joyce Shepherd were honored by the Atlanta Business League as top black women of influence. The list reflects the names of women and Metro Atlanta who have reached senior level positions, who are leading entrepreneurs, and who have extensive community involvement. Since 1994, the Atlanta Business League has recognized business owners, professionals, community organizers, and civic leaders who have made significant contributions. Those looking for music, food, and fun came out to Summer Hill for a good time. And the Adams Park Foundation has quite a few things to be proud of. Stay with us. Senior citizens and grandparents had a blast at the Movin' and Groovin' celebration when the Department of Parks and Rec honored the older members of our community by encouraging them to get their bodies in motion. They gathered at the Cohen Park Recreation Center to have a day full of activities. The city held the event to promote a positive attitude towards aging and leading a healthy, active, and independent life. Some council members showed their appreciation to those who have made significant contributions to their district. Peebo Bryson was also there, and he wooed the ladies.
Is there any chance? I just can't believe you're not lonely too. Just for me and you, now baby, can you stop the rain?
Thank you so much.
The event is designed to help seniors stay active through community programs and outreach initiatives. The Atlanta Beltline Southeast 8K kicked off in Boulevard Crossing Park. The route took runners and walkers through the beautiful new D.H. Stanton Park.
We went through six neighborhoods and two Beltline parks. We broke a record with the registrations, and it was an 8K, very hilly, very challenging, but so much fun.
There were a bunch of fun things to do, including playing soccer with the Atlanta Silverbacks. There were pickup games for all ages. They were rocking and rolling at the second annual Summer Hill Fall Fest. The festival featured live music, an artist market, a dog zone, and lots of food. There was plenty to see and do, including an adult big wheel race.
When you live in town, it's kind of hard to get out and meet your neighbors, so this is really a great chance for all the neighbors to come around, enjoy some really great food, enjoy some great music, and just get to know one another.
The Summer Hill neighborhood is between Grant Park and Turner Field. Those in and around District 11 were invited to the Adams Park Cultural Arts Festival. They enjoyed a day in the park with a 5K run and activities for kids, teens, and the whole family. The afternoon also included a health fair, a food market, and jazz.
And this is, it's beautiful green space. And the Friends of Adams Park have just done an amazing job of maintaining and restoring this park, working with our Department of Parks and Recreation, just to make this a place that can really be the center of our community.
Bottoms presented a proclamation recognizing that Adams Park was placed on the National Register of Historic Places earlier this year. And a Georgia Urban Forestry Award may be in order. The awards committee was impressed with the success the Adams Park Foundation had in raising neighborhood awareness about the threat of English ivy to trees. The awards luncheon is October 24th in Columbus, Georgia. Registration is underway for President Mitchell's College Prep Series. The first event is the PSAT and the Princeton Review Assessment, or PRA. The PRA gauges whether a student is better suited to take the SAT or the ACT. Testing is October 19th at 8 a.m. at Benjamin E. Mays High School. The second event is in the atrium here at City Hall on October 29th at 6:30. That's when students get their scores back. To register for the College Prep Series, call 1-800-273-8439. That's 1-800-2-REVIEW. October is Bike to Work Month. Bike lovers from all over the metro area came to Woodruff Park for the Department of Planning and Community Development's second annual Bike Expo. The expo raises awareness about bike safety and bicycle culture, which has been on the rise in Atlanta in recent years. And the city is in the process of implementing 26 bike projects. A cycle track was recently added to 10th Street in Midtown.
The goal of this is to help kick off the Bike to Work Challenge, which is organized by the Clean Air Campaign. And the goal of the challenge is to get folks to start riding their bike to work, not every day, maybe once every couple weeks, once a week.
A new lane is being installed on Ponce de Leon Avenue. The city is dedicating nearly $2.5 million to fund new bicycle projects. One of the people credited with lifting the profile of bicycle travel in Atlanta is Joshua Mello, Assistant Director of Planning and Transportation for the city. Mello was recently awarded the Professional of the Year Award by the Association of Pedestrian and Bicycle Professionals. He was only one of two people nationwide to win the honor.
It's just great to be recognized for the work that we've been doing, and all of our project partners and folks that I work with on a daily basis deserve a lot of the credit for the award.
Georgia is on my mind and in my mail, and the beat goes on at Music Midtown. That's next. The annual BET Hip Hop Awards has become one of the most popular events of the year here in Atlanta. A lot goes into organizing the event, and a group of lucky kids from the Centers of Hope got a behind-the-scenes look at what goes into producing a major awards program.
The BET Hip Hop Awards are held annually right here in the city of Atlanta, on the stage of the Atlanta Civic Center. A lot goes into this production. It's considered one of the most popular television events of the year.
We've been working for a whole week now, up to this point, just to get it ready.
Executive producer Lynn Harris Taylor is talking to a group of lucky students from Atlanta's Center of Hope. They got to go behind the scenes and view the rehearsals of the 2013 BET Hip Hop Awards show.
Today is a rehearsal day. We'll have most of our talent come in today, and everyone gets a block of about 30 minutes to get on stage and knock it out so that all the camera people can look at their rehearsal and decide what shots to take.
It's an amazing opportunity because I watch it every year, and it's so wonderful to see how it is like in here and compare it to how it is on the television.
In addition to Q&A with producers, students were treated to a tour of the production office. a look at where the press will be positioned to greet their favorite hip-hop stars. And then there were a few surprises.
What's up, darling?
Rapper 2 Chainz took a break in his rehearsal to say hello to the students. Tiffany Bryant is a program director for the Centers of Hope.
I hope they'll come away inspired to pursue non-traditional jobs that can be just as lucrative as the ones that they see in front of the screen.
This will be a highlight of your year this year. Do well in school, do your best, always do your best, and just know that anything is possible.
2 months ago, we brought you a story about original artwork on display along Concourse D at the airport. The art was created by students who attend high schools throughout Metro Atlanta. The paintings were displayed along temporary construction walls, and if you liked them, you could buy them. Well, Hartsfield Jackson and Delaware North Travel Hospitality Services are pleased to announce that every piece of artwork created by these very talented high school students sold.
This whole idea of installing art projects, legitimate art projects, on temporary barricades for concessions construction is a new approach for us. Most of the time what we do is we put up an approved message that tells you what the brand name is using a previously city-approved logo. But this is something that is outside the box for us.
The artwork raised $9,000 to support various high school arts programs. Congratulations. R&B performer Ashanti helped honor Georgia native Ray Charles at Morehouse College. Now the U.S. Postal Service has a commemorative stamp of the Father of Soul as part of its Music Icons Forever stamp series. Friend and fellow musician Kenny Rogers was also at the unveiling. Along with Ashanti, the Morehouse College Glee Club performed another Ray Charles hit, Georgia on My Mind. Ray Charles stamp is a limited release, and you can get the stamps from any post office. Rain didn't stop music lovers from heading out to Piedmont Park for Music Midtown. Even though the grounds were soggy, people still showed up for a weekend of concerts by their favorite bands. Because of the rain and patrons, the Department of Parks and Recreation is busy repairing the grounds so that it will be ready for the next big event at that Midtown Park. Thank you for watching City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel.
Georgia, Georgia.